I can see the family gathering, sweet faces all familiar, and no one old and feeble anymore. This lonesome heart is crying, thank God, spread my wings for flight. Lord, I've never been this homesick before. Amen. Oh, see the bright light shine, hallelujah, just about home time. I can see my Father standing at the door, hallelujah, this world is but a wilderness. Oh, I'm ready for deliverance. Oh, I've never been this homesick before. See the bright lights, oh, see the bright lights shine, hallelujah, just about home time. I can see my Father standing at the door. Again, I can see the family gathered, sweet faces all familiar, and no one old and feeble anymore. Oh, this lonesome heart is crying, thank God, spread my wings for flight. Lord, I've never been this homesick before. Amen. Brother Jack, oh, see the bright light shine. It's just about home time. I can see my Father standing at the door. This world has been a wilderness.
How many's homesick?
Amen. I love that song. Amen. I appreciate that so much. Let's take our Bibles this evening and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 6, and we'll move along quickly. My true heart's desire is to always get you out of here before 9. But sometimes it doesn't happen. But I love you anyways. Amen. Praise God. Tonight, we're going to read this passage out of 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and starting at verse 14. And I want to verse 14. And we'll be speaking on blended religion this evening. Verse 14. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? Now that rules out altogether missionary dating. Can't date somebody to try to save them. Well, I'll turn him around, I'll change him, I'll change her. There's no place for that in the Word of God. Amen. That's not what we're talking about. That's just, it's just fun to say. Verse 15, and what concord with Christ has Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. And I will be a father unto you, and ye shall be sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Just ask the Lord to bless the reading of his word. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful word. We ask, God, that you would just anoint the preaching of the gospel this evening. God, as I just yield myself to your spirit, I pray that you would move beyond the thoughts and abilities of a man, a lump of clay, just a piece of dirt. But Lord, it'd be more than that, Lord, that it would be you operating a divine gift that you've placed inside this lump of clay, and that you would speak right to your people, Lord. I pray that you would have preeminence in this place and that you would take every spirit under your control, Lord. We ask it in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. You can be seated. Amen. I want to remind everybody that we have a youth meeting this Friday night with Brother Marcus Becker. He's in town, but he's actually over at Bible Believers. This evening, Kyle and Carrie Weikert took him over there. He's staying with them, and so he's there tonight, but he'll be here Friday night for a youth meeting in the fellowship hall. All the area churches are invited. We will be providing the pizza, so if you can bring sides and drinks, that'd be wonderful. So, and pray for those meetings, and Brother Marcus will be ministering for us here Sunday, so be praying for those services. Amen. In the Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 15 says, "Take us the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes." Brother Branham says in Just Once More, Lord, in 1963, "Listen, destroy your enemy before your enemy destroys you. He'll do it. Bring back the old-fashioned meetings and things, and oh, leave Delilah alone, leave the world alone. That things that woo you off into little things you shouldn't." Amen. So in Solomon, he's saying, take us the foxes, and that word take means to capture or to bind the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vines, because our vines have tender grapes. And in the vineyard, they would put a fence or a hedge or something around the vineyard to protect the young grapes, because foxes would come and gnaw on the branches and eat the grapes. And so there was protection, amen, for the cattle not getting into the vineyard and for the horses and the beast of the field. But sometimes the little foxes would slip in little holes in the hedge and dig down under and get in, and they would spoil the vines. And he's saying, catch those little foxes that spoil the vines. And that's what Brother Branham's saying. He's saying, leave Delilah alone. He's talking about Samson and Delilah. And Samson had a gift given from God. He had a commission that came from God. And God had given him a supernatural and a supernatural strength that came because he was a consecrated vessel. So his strength came because he had the vow of a Nazarite, and he was told not to violate that vow of the Nazarite. Don't eat grapes, don't drink anything from the vine, don't cut your hair, because you're under a Nazarite vow. It was actually given to his mother, and it was passed on to him. And as long as he kept his vow of consecration, because that's what a Nazarite vow is, a vow of consecration to the Lord, his strength remained. But when he began to dabble with Delilah, and Delilah was constantly trying to get at his strength, right? And when she did, when she got at his strength, when he dropped the bar of his consecration and he let out the secret of his consecration, then Delilah came in and cut off the sign of Samson's consecration, which was his locks of hair. And when she did that, he lost the God-given strength that had given him. He lost the gift of God that was upon him, because he played too much with Delilah and began to toy around with his consecration. He didn't have value in it like he should have. And Brother Ram says, leave Delilah alone. Leave the world alone. That thing that woos you off into little things that you shouldn't. Amen. There's all kinds of little things that woo you off this direction and woo you and I off in this direction. And he's saying, leave those things alone. Let's turn together to 1 John chapter 2. I want to read a couple passages of scripture together. First John chapter 2, verse 15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Now, when Brother Branham talks about this scripture, he says, now that's not enjoying a sunset or the mountaintop or the trees or the valley or a hike or a picnic. He's not saying the creation of God you're not supposed to love. There's nothing wrong with enjoying God's creation. When he's talking world here, he's talking in the systems of man. And we live in the pinnacle of the systems of man. We live in Satan's Eden, and we're told not to love the world or the things of the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away in the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Let's turn back to Luke chapter 8. Just want to lay a foundation here in the scriptures. Luke chapter 8, verse 11. Jesus tells a parable. He tells a parable about a seed sower and all the places that seed lands and all the things that happen to the seed. And here he's going to bring the interpretation of the parable. In verse 11, he says, "Now the parable is this, the seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are they that hear, then cometh the devil and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. They on the rock are they which when they hear receive the word with joy, and these have no root which for a while believe and in time of temptation fall away. And that which fell among thorns are they which when they have heard go forth and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life and bring no fruit to perfection. But that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart having heard the word keep it and bring forth fruit with patience." There's one of those that you have to wait on. The one that falls in good ground brings forth fruit with patience. That's the challenge for many believers, is to wait with patience for the seed. The seed will produce good fruit. If the good seed falls in good ground, it will produce good fruit. Amen. But you have to wait with patience. So we want to look at verse 14. He says, "Those that are fell among the thorns are they which when they heard go forth and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life." We live in a world that offers pleasures on every hand. Pleasures on every corner, pleasures in every form. It's a pleasure-loving, mad society that we live in. Even Paul in 2 Timothy is talking about all those that forsaken him, and he's saying, "Demas hath forsaken me." Why? Having loved this present world. Demas wasn't willing to any longer pay the price of separation or pay the price of consecration, but he had a love for an affection for the world, and so he left Paul and went back. I'm just going to read to you a short passage of scripture out of Titus 2, verse 11. "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world." Now, those are some deliberate terms. We teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Now, I want to talk about soberly today for a little while, because there's a certain intoxication that comes with pleasure, right? Having fun and always having fun, and the next thing's got to be funner than the thing we did before, and that was fun, but now this is boring, and I'm looking for something else that's fun to do. Yeah. Amen? That's the society that we live in. It's always the next trip or the next outing or the next social event, because regular life is boring, so there always must be something to stimulate, something to stimulate the senses. There's got to be, that's why it's so sad, but children, you know, sometimes just for parents to have a free moment, they'll take children and they'll set them in front of a video or set them in front of a game, or they're watching the DVD player when they're driving from one errand to the next errand, or they're playing on mom and dad's phone or tablet in the grocery store just so they'll be quiet, because that child cannot live a regular life, because a regular life doesn't have enough stimulation anymore, because their entire life has been stimulated. They're being stimulated to death, and now regular life has no pleasure, has no satisfaction, can't live just a regular life, so we're always seeking more pleasure, and pleasure can be intoxicating. Dulling the senses, we're listening to music all the time, or watching videos all the time, or chatting with friends all the time. When was the last time we just shut everything off and rode quietly with no sound except our own thoughts? Is that frightening? It shouldn't be. But our senses are so bombarded all the time that as soon as we find ourselves without something to do, we're thinking of who we got to call or text or I got to check something on my phone. Nobody just sits still anymore. When was the last time you saw somebody sit on a park bench and watch ducks swim in the pond? They're the ones who are a little off in the head, right, down at the park. There's something wrong with them because everybody else is walking through the park checking their phone all the time, stimulated all the time. It's intoxicating. But we're told to be sober. And to be sober means to have your senses, to have your wits about you, to contemplate and be decisive in what you do, just not caught up in what we're doing. And that's what we want to talk about tonight. And it may take a twist for you and for me, but it's not just, I'm not just talking about going to bars and getting drunk and watching movies. That's part of the thing we have to watch is the evil worldliness, but it's the worldliness creeping into the church that's much more dangerous. And that's really what we want to talk about. If we could turn to Joshua chapter 24 together and read a portion of scripture. Joshua chapter 24, verse 1. And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel and Shechem and called for the elders of Israel and for the heads and for their judges and for their officers, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said unto all the people, "Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah, the father of Abraham, the father of Nahor, and they served other gods." Now, I want to clarify something here. It's a little confusing if we don't understand, because this is a complicated translation. It says, your father dwelt on the other side of the flood, Terah and Abraham. Well, Terah and Abraham weren't on the other side of Noah's flood. We know that. They weren't before Noah, they were after Noah. But this word flood means stream or river. So here they are in the promised land, the stream or river they're talking about is Jordan, and your fathers lived on the other side of Jordan because they lived in the land of Chaldees, which is Babylon. Are we all comfortable with that? From Chaldea, and Chaldea is where Babylon's out of. It's where Ur was and the land of the Chaldees, which is where Iran is right now, or Iraq right now. So it's straight east of Israel. So he's saying not that your fathers lived before the flood. That's impossible. They lived on the other side of Jordan before they came into the land. But he said they served other gods. And I took your father Abraham from the other side of the flood and led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his seed and gave him Isaac. And I gave unto Isaac Jacob and Esau, and I gave unto Esau Mount Seir and to possess it. But Jacob and his children went down into Egypt. So he's going to start talking about the land of Ur, which was in Shinar, which is called Babylonia, which is where Babel was and where Babylon rose up out of. And then Jacob even went down into Egypt. And that's important when you get over to verse 14. He says, now therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. So he's making a clear-cut distinction. He says, your fathers served over in the land of Ur. They served other gods. And Jacob even went down into Egypt and was introduced to other gods. But don't you serve any of those other gods. Amen. There was a time that before we came to the message, many of us, that we served other things. Served other gods, amen. We were caught in denominationalism. Brother Branham said, worship meaning the devil and not even knowing it. But he said, there's a time that you came out of that and have been delivered out of that, and do not go back to those things. Let's look at chapter 23 in Joshua, verse 4. Just back one page or maybe two in your Bible. It says, behold, in verse 4 of 23, behold, I have divided unto you by lot these nations that remain to be an inheritance for your tribes from Jordan, with all the nations that I have cut off, even unto the great sea westward. And the Lord your God, he shall expel them from before you and drive them from out of your sight, and ye shall possess their land as the Lord your God hath promised unto you. Be therefore very courageous to keep and to do all the things written in the book of the law of Moses, that you turn not aside therefrom to the right hand or to the left. Now, Brother Branham tells us very clearly that Israel and the great Exodus types the church coming out of denominationalism. And he says you can run the typology, and the church is typed there by the nation of Israel, and they came out and they were separated, and they went in and they possessed the land, which he told us the land is the word, and all the inhabitants of the word were driven off of the word. Amen. All those that were squatting upon it, because it belongs to the bride. So under the capstone message, the word was laid out bare, and we're able now to go possess the land. And God drove out through the opening of the seals, God drove out all the inhabitants that were sitting there saying, "It's mine." The Baptists with eternal security, and the Catholics with the universal church, and all these different doctrines that they said belonged to them. We drove them out and said, "No, this land is mine." Amen. So we come in to possess the land, but he said, be very courageous. Not just courageous, but very courageous. But he didn't say be very courageous to drive out the inhabitants. No. He didn't say be very courageous in war, be very courageous in suffering. No. He said be very courageous to keep everything that Moses told you to do. Because it was going to take a great deal of courage to keep the word. And I say the parallel runs today. Be very courageous to keep the word of God true. Be very courageous not to blend, not to mix, not to drop the bars, but be very courageous to do all. Here's how he says it. Be very courageous to keep and to do all that is written in the book of the law of Moses, that you turn not aside therefrom to the right hand or to the left. No deviation whatsoever from the pure word that the prophet brought. And here we stand in a parallel setting. We stand here and we're calling out to us to be courageous and to keep all the law that is written in the book. Keep all of the word. And the opening of the seals revealed to us what that word was and what we're to do with that word and how we're to keep that word. And the prophet of God explained how we're to dress, how we're to act, how we're to set a church in order, how we're to do these things, and be very courageous to keep it all and to stray not to the right hand and not to the left. We don't need courage to take the mountain. We don't need to be very courageous to take the mountain or to face the devil. What we need to be very courageous to do is to keep the word. To keep it pure, to keep it unmixed, to keep it unblended, and keep it from the thoughts of man. That's what you need courage for today. Because that will put you in opposition to almost everyone. Amen? That'll just keeping the pure word of God that he delivered through the mouth of a prophet, to keep it and to keep it the way it was brought and to keep it in purity according to the word, will put you in opposition to almost everybody around you. Verse 6 again, be therefore very courageous to keep and to do all that is written in the book of the law of Moses, that you turn not aside therefrom to the right hand or to the left, that you come not among these nations, these that remain among you, neither make mention of the name of their gods, nor cause to swear by them, neither serve them, nor bow yourselves unto them, but cleave unto the Lord your God as ye have done unto this day. For the Lord hath driven out from before you great nations and strong, but as for you, no man hath been able to stand before you unto this day. One man of you shall chase 1,000, for the Lord your God, he it is that fighteth for you, as he hath promised you. Take good heed therefore unto yourselves, that you love the Lord your God. Else if you do in any wise go back, remember, the inhabitants of the land were the denominations. Be separate from the denominations. Don't take part in any of the denominations. Don't even mention the names of their gods. Take nothing back that was driven out. Take nothing back that was supposed to be driven out, but keep the word pure and take nothing back. He says, now verse 12, else if you do in any wise go back and cleave unto the remnant of these nations, even these that remain among you, and shall make marriages with them and go in unto them and they to you, know for a certainty that the Lord your God will no more drive out any of these nations from before you. Your victory ends the moment you go back and compromise. The moment that Israel, no, he says, no man, I drove out nations that were stronger than thee. I drove out nations that were mightier than thee, and no man could stand before thee. But the very moment that you drop the bar, the very moment that you go back to what you were delivered from, the very moment that you go back into the nations, your victory will end. Because it's not man-made, it's God-given. Know for a certainty that the Lord your God will no more drive out any of these nations from before you, but they shall be snares and traps unto you, and scourges in your sides and thorns in your eyes, until you perish from all this good land which the Lord your God hath given you. That is a pretty strong statement. God was not messing around. He was not playing games. He had called a people out, a nation out of the nations, to be a peculiar people, to be a separated people unto himself. He didn't want any blending. He didn't want any mixing. He didn't want any compromise. And I say the same thing is true today. He's called, amen, he's called a bride out of the denominational systems, and he wants her to stand true to the word that was delivered, and he doesn't want her to go to the right hand or to the left or to go back or to take anything from the other nations, but to take everything from the word. Amen. We don't need to compromise with those things. And we don't need to go back to those things that we were delivered from. Amen. We were delivered from television. We were delivered from movies. We were delivered from unrighteousness and unholiness and perverted music. We were delivered from those things. We need not go back to them. Amen. No compromise. If we could pull up the PowerPoint, I just want to do a little, show you a little something that I've been studying. I want to remind you, I'm going to read a few quotes that I read last time, but I'm still studying down this vein of this Babylon coming through all the Gentile nations. How many remember we've been talking about that? When Daniel saw the vision, he saw Babylon as the head of gold, moved down to the arms of silver, and moved down to the waist of brass and to the legs of iron, mixed with the iron and clay going out to the toes. And Brother Branham taught us that was these nations coming down, you know, one to the other, as they took more world domination. The old one would pass off, but the anointing would pass down to the next one. And the anointing would pass down to the next one. So we wind up with Rome being the two legs of iron, and it mixed with clay, it mixed with humanity, and it's went into all the world. And that's that Romanism, that anointing is the anointing that's upon the world. And so Brother Branham talks about civilization moving from the east to the west. And I'm going to read this quote again from Remember the Lord. We're getting in the last hours now. The sun is setting. Civilization has come from the east. Now it's on the west coast. It can go no farther. The barrier is there, and all the sin of the world is heaping up and rolling up in shameful waves of Hollywood. So now we saw that from Babylon, it moved to the Medes and the Persians. It's moving west. And then it comes to the Greeks, it's moving west. Then it comes to Rome, it's moving west. But when it comes to Rome, now after Rome and Daniel's vision, there's no other nation mentioned. So did it stop there? Was that the end of Gentile domination? No, it went on. It went on into Eastern Europe and went on into Western Europe. Then it crossed the Atlantic Ocean. It came to the United States. But what was it? It didn't change anymore its form. It didn't come to a new national head. Now it moved from the nation of Rome to the papacy of Rome. And now that has followed every civilization that sprung up from that point on. As soon as a nation would spring up, Catholicism was right behind it to intermingle the iron and the clay. Mingle with humanity till it comes all the way over. So as the sun rises from the east and sets in the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. So Brother Bram say civilization's moving from the east to the west, and now it's over in Hollywood, over on the west coast of the United States, and it can go no farther. That's why it's going to drop off the face of the earth and be sunk, because it's going to be judged. But here's what he said. Civilization has come from the east to west. I'm repeating. And now it's on the west coast. It can go no farther. The barrier is there, and all of the sin of the world is heaping up and rolling up in shameful waves of Hollywood. Now think about that. All the sin, Satan's Eden, it's all heaping up and rolling up because it can't go any farther. It's hit the barrier, and it's rolling up there. And then he says, it's bounced plumb back into the church. That's what we got to be careful of. I just want to show this. If we could bring up the, am I on my first slide? Okay. I'm looking here at the western half of the United States, and you can see here's Los Angeles and here's San Francisco. These are two cities I'm going to talk about, two prominent cities on the West Coast. But I just want to show you all the picture studios that are here in Los Angeles, Paramount, Sony Pictures, DreamWorks, Warner Brothers, Walt Disney, 20th Century Fox, Universal Studios, it goes on and on and on. But Brother Branham said, we used to go to Paris to get our filth, and that used to go over to the world. Now it comes out of Hollywood. Hollywood's producing the filth and sending it out to all nations. But I want you to notice, there's three names I want you to remember: Sony Pictures, DreamWorks, and 20th Century Fox. But then I wanted to look at something else that's out on the West Coast, in Silicon Valley. In Silicon Valley, you have Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, Pinterest, and Netflix. Now remember, civilization's traveled to the West, and it's heaping up in rolls of filthiness, and it's bouncing back from Hollywood to the church, so it's going out. So where are all these influences over the world coming from? Amen. It's coming from out west. It's coming from the West Coast. It's coming from the ending of civilization. It's coming where all the worldliness and Satan's Eden is heaping up and rolling up and bouncing back into the church. How's it bouncing back into the church? Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, Pinterest, Netflix. And the list goes on. We'll get into more because I don't want you to forget Sony, DreamWorks, and 20th Century Fox. Those will come up and be important in a minute. So I am in no way saying that you're bound for hell and you're not a Christian if you're ever on one of these. I'm not saying that at all, but I'm saying these are the things that influence the world. It used to be that when somebody had a new way of thinking and they wanted to rebel against something and they wanted to write a book with their ideas, they would have to write parchments or scrolls and write them out, and then they'd have to be hand copied and passed around, and carriers would have to carry them from one place to the other, and they would be read, and the idea would be passed along, and maybe after 15, 20, 25 years, this new idea, this new concept starts to take root in an area and starts to grow. And then it changed, and now they had a printing press where they could print books much faster, and distribution got easier with ships and with carriages and all these things. And so the idea could spread. So now within 10 years, you could have an idea. That's how the Reformation spread so quickly. But now all you have to do is take an influential person with over 100,000 people tapped into their Instagram account, and all they have to do is give a thought over Instagram, and now you've got 100, 200, 300,000 people influenced in a moment. And then they think that's neat, and they copy it, and they pass it on to however many is linked to them, and they pass it on to however many is linked to them. And before you know it, they've had times where, with just in a few days, this happened with Caitlyn Jenner, the man who had a transgender operation. I don't know what to call it, changed from male to female, Caitlyn opened a new Instagram account, I believe it was her Twitter, and it got 500,000 people connected to that in just, I think, 36 hours, or I can't remember the day. It's unbelievable how quickly. So here you can have millions of people influenced with a thought in a matter of hours. There's never been a day like this day. There's never been a time like this time. And where's it coming from? It's coming from the West Coast. Now, Georgia was trying to pass a bill where they were going to have bathroom protection for children, where they're not going to let this transgender thing go in the bathrooms. And they got threatened from who? Who threatened them? Hollywood. The movie star started saying, we'll never work in Georgia. We'll never film movies in Georgia. We'll never endorse anything in Georgia anymore. Yep. Who cares? I'd say good. But it started, because there was an economic impact, now they started to tremble. Under what? The influence of a handful of people. Where? Out on the West Coast. Now they're using Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, and they're using these things, and now they're fighting out their message, and they're signaling out their message, and people are being influenced by what they're reading coming across. And you can't tell me you're not influenced, because we may be as holy as we want to be, but every time you read something very disturbing in the news or very troubling on Facebook about somebody else, guess what? It has an impact on you. You read something grieving, you read something disappointing or discouraging, and now all of a sudden you're disappointed, you're discouraged. It has an effect on your spirit, whether you want it to or not. I mean, sometimes just reading the news has a drastic effect on your spirit. There's many times I wish I hadn't read what I just read. Man, because we live in such a wicked society. And so we got to realize where these things are coming from. We got to be careful. These aren't things we just open ourselves to. We've got to be careful. Now, I want to read a quote here from Uniting Time and Sign from 1963. Now, you see, we're living the uniting time when we see these things being united. Oh, why we fail to see those things. You can look in here in the scripture and see where that it was promised that what he would do. We see it coming to pass. We see the church, what he promised to do, we see it coming to pass. We see the nations uniting together. We see the isms uniting together. We see the churches uniting together. It's uniting time. It's the hour of uniting. That's the spirit of the age. Now, I want you to keep that in your mind, because what's happening right now in our world is everything is consolidating in the business world. Little businesses are selling out the medium-sized businesses. Medium-sized businesses are selling out the larger businesses. And these big investment firms and these big money holders are starting to gobble up all of these companies, and it's working from the bottom up. They're buying, buying, buying. They're always selling to somebody above them and buying up. So now we have a situation where fewer and fewer entities are controlling the economics of the entire world. That's by design. How many times you hear about a merger? A merger. If you just listen carefully, you hear it on the news every week. Somebody is buying somebody, and they're consolidating, and things are becoming larger. That's the spirit of the age. We've got to unite. Everything you talk about has got to be organized. Later on, he says, it's a uniting time. It all has to go through some union of some sort, and that union is the very thing that brings the mark of the beast. See, it's a uniting time, and it's working right on up to that. What's he talking about? That union or whatever is going to come in. That's going to be an organization. He says it's uniting time, and this uniting time is working right on up into that. You can see it just with your plain eyes if you'd look at it. It's uniting time where everything is uniting together. All right. Now I want you to hold on to that. This is the spirit upon the ages, uniting time. That's why these businesses are merging and buying one another up so fast. It's not because any other reason. There's a spirit of uniting. All right, it's taking over the whole world. Brother Bram says in Christianity versus idolatry, now I'm going to draw a parallel here, so just hang with me. Don't forget what we're talking about. That's right, you've got to know the word. Stay on the word. See, the great battle is at hand. Now, we've played church for years and years, but the hour's come now that when Jambres and Jannes will withstand Moses as the Bible said they would. And it's going to be spiritual battle, conflict. There'll be some just continue on. The denominational church will just move right on into domination and go on the way it goes. But I mean, the real true believer is coming to that battlefield, and you better be versed and know what you're doing, or you could take an evil spirit so easy and not know it. That's a scary thought. He's not talking about the denomination. He said they're going to go right on. He said the true believer. The true believer, you better be versed and know what you're doing, or you could take an evil spirit so easy and not know. If it's contrary to this word, don't believe it. Stay with that word. That's the safety net. That's the security blanket. That's where the believer must stay, in the revealed word of the hour. Amen. Or else you could take an evil spirit so easy and not know it. How does it come down? Through thoughts, anointed thoughts that are spoken or typed out and sent around the world. Don't forget, spirits travel on words. Whether they're written or whether they're spoken, spirits travel on words. And we could be opening ourselves up to something and not realizing what it is. In Christianity versus idolatry, Brother Branham said, so many people today are opening their hearts to the wrong thing. You get a spirit all right, but many times it contradicts the word, saying the days of miracles is past, there's no such thing as this or that. Remember, that's a devil under the disguisement of Christianity. Anything that will contradict the word, even if it's Christian material, if it contradicts the word as it's been told to us through a prophet, that is, listen, he said, that is the devil under the disguisement of Christianity. That is not somebody made a mistake. That is not they're doing the best with what they have. That's not the anointing that's there. The people may be doing the best with what they have. The people may be doing the best with the understanding they have. They may be trying their hardest, but that's not the spirit that's anointing that thing. The person, we have nothing against the person, but that spirit is the devil under disguisement, contradicting the word of God. He says, you're opening your hearts to the wrong thing. You can get a spirit all right. That's the devil under disguisement of Christianity. God help us when we get down into this after a bit, you'll see it, that it's an evil spirit in the disguisement of Christianity. But it isn't the spirit of Christ, because the spirit of Christ comes to the word every time. Amen. He can't deny his own word. That's an easy, easy, easy test. If it contradicts the word, it's not of God. Right. If it agrees with the word, all of the word, it's of God. Okay. Want to talk about, just for a minute, don't forget what we're talking about. Stay with me, because I want to bring some stuff out here in a second. But when Elijah showed up on Mount Carmel for the showdown, Elijah wasn't just fighting Balaam, the worship of Baal. He wasn't just fighting the false prophets of Baal. He made a statement that was very telling about the situation in Israel at that time. He said, "Why halt ye between two opinions?" It wasn't that they had rejected Jehovah to serve Baal. It was that they halted between two opinions. He said, if Baal be God, serve him. If Jehovah be God, serve him. What was happening is they had a mixed religion. They were doing both. They were serving Baal and they were serving Jehovah. They had not done what Joshua had told them. He says, be very courageous to keep all that was written from Moses and stray not to the right hand or to the left. They had gotten off of that mark, and they had picked up things from the nations that were driven out, which they were not supposed to do, and they had gone back and they had brought things in, and they mixed it with true religion. And that was what Elijah was calling out. Why halt you between two opinions? If Baal is God, serve him. If Jehovah is God, serve him. But stop the mixed religion. And that is what's being sold to the world today, is a mixed, blended religion. God is not in a mixed religion. God cannot be worshiped in a mixed religion. He's worshiped in spirit and in truth. VeggieTales, by Big Idea Entertainment, got sold not too long ago, and Big Idea Entertainment is now owned by DreamWorks Animation. If you have a list of what DreamWorks Animation puts out, it is not godly. Why does DreamWorks Animation own Big Idea Entertainment that's producing Christian material? It's uniting time. These things that you find in the Christian bookstore cannot be trusted. This can be trusted. The message of the hour that's come through a vindicated prophet can be trusted, but nothing that you find in the Bible bookstore can be trusted. And I'll show you why. Fireproof, Courageous, The War Room are co-produced by Affirm Films, Provident Films. Now, we know that the Sherwood Baptist Church started making these movies, and then the Kendricks brothers got on board, and they're the co-producers, but when they began to grow through their next movies, then Hollywood wanted to get on board because they were very profitable, so now they have a co-producer and a distributor of their things. So I hope I can remember this. There's about three different brands that started distributing their projects. TriStar Productions, Destination Films, and Affirm began to distribute, and then Affirm Films, which is also Provident Films, became a co-producer. They funded the project. Affirm Films and Provident Films is owned by Sony Pictures. What is Sony Pictures doing in the Christian film industry? See, everything's uniting. Uniting. You're either uniting to one of two things. You're either uniting to Christ, the capstone, or you're uniting to Satan, to Satan's Eden. That's it. Only two things. What do you think this is uniting to? What's Sony Pictures interested in?
Right.
I'm telling you, it's not what you think they're interested in. They have an ungodly agenda. The Sony group is what produces PlayStation and all the vile, wicked games that are on there. Vile movies and vile this and that all over the place. And now they're the owner of Provident Films, TriStar Pictures, Destination Films. All of these produce Christian films. And all of them fly under a different name, but behind all of those names is Sony Pictures. That is very interesting. Okay, that's it for that. I got one more. Provident Films, which is owned by Sony, is in with Provident Labels, and Provident Labels is a music producer, and they're a music producer for five or six different labels. And those labels, I can't remember them all, they're all kinds of different labels. So when you go and you pick up a CD in the Bible bookstore, because Provident Labels does only Christian music, and Provident Films only does Christian films. You go and pick up the CD at the Bible bookstore, and you look at it on the back, it may say whatever labels, whatever recording, whatever this. Well, five or six of those major recording studios are owned by Provident Labels, which is owned by Sony worldwide.
Right.
So Sony, and most of the names that you know, most of the names that you know when I looked them up, they're there under those different labels, which is under Provident Labels, which is under Sony Pictures. So you tell me when the persecution comes down from the Catholic Church, when the beast system starts to squeeze up, what's going to happen? It's already happening. There's a blending of religion already taking place. Nothing is what it appears to be. The other one that I thought was interesting is Zondervan. Everybody heard of Zondervan?
Yeah.
If you look on the edge of your Bible, it probably says either Zondervan or Thomas Nelson. Zondervan and Thomas Nelson are two different brands along with others that are owned by HarperCollins. HarperCollins is owned by News Corp. News Corp is owned by Rupert Murdoch. So Rupert Murdoch owns the company that makes your Bible. That should scare you. That should frighten you. Rupert Murdoch also owns 21st Century Fox, which is Fox News, known as Fox. And he also owns 20th Century Fox, which is the movie studio out in Hollywood. See how Hollywood has infiltrated the church? Can you see it now?
Amen.
Hollywood has infiltrated Christian literature, Christian Bibles, and Christian music. And we think it's safe. This is safe.
Amen.
Brother Branham said, in God's power to transform, Cain was such a person as that. He was very religious indeed. Now, if religion is all that you have to have, then God was unjust by condemning Cain because he was religious. He was just as religious and sincere as Abel was. Now, remember, he thought of God. He worshiped God. He had a church. He built an altar. He made a sacrifice. He prayed. He worshiped. But he was rejected no matter. Esau was also. See, religion, see, that's Satan's business, not to kill the whole thing, but just contaminate it. Think about it. Satan's business is not to kill religion. It's not to kill churches. It's not to kill movies, Christian movies, or to kill Christian music or Christian books. It's to contaminate it. The stream, the financial stream that follows Christian literature, Christian movies, and Christian songs, that financial stream leads you right back to the seat of Satan, Hollywood itself. And don't think that they don't have influence all the way down. Whoever has the money has influence. You think we get real news? We don't get real news. We get whatever news wants to be fed to us by ever who controls it up the top. All the news agencies pretty much in America are controlled by two or three different entities.
Right.
So just go and study it for yourself. You can find out. So things are not always what they appear to be. Brother Branham in the first seal was talking about the white horse rider. He said, that's what the white horse rider under the way of white righteous church, but an antichrist. It got to look a horse even, just like Christ is coming on a horse. Anti, so close it'd deceive the very elect, if possible. But it won't deceive the very elect. Brothers and sisters, we're coming to the pinnacle of the capstone, and it cuts everything out but the word. Everything out. There's things that were acceptable before, but as you go higher in Christ, you find yourself honed down, and they're not acceptable anymore. They were acceptable at the base because there was ignorance there and there was a blood covering for ignorance. But as we came up through the ages, less became acceptable and less became acceptable because God was pouring out more of his word. And as he poured out more of his word, he poured out an equal portion of his spirit to keep the word. And so now we've come to the full unveiling of Christ, the full revelation of the word, and it's brought back the fullness of the Holy Ghost back in the church again. So now there's an equal measure of spirit to keep the word. So what was acceptable before is no longer acceptable because there's no ignorance to those things that's been exposed. Amen. But yet, we're not asked to do it in our own strength. All we have to do is get in the Spirit. Praise the Lord. Now, there's one other book that when I was studying, I just grabbed little snapshots. So you want to go and dig into these things yourself and find out whether what I'm telling you is true or not. Go find out. But I just grabbed a piece here and a piece there and a piece there. So it's immense. But there's a book that I started looking up called Jesus Calling. It was a devotion book that I've heard a lot about. And I may even have it in my house. I don't know. I've got all kinds of stuff. But we have this in our church library, is the children's storybook version of Jesus Calling. So every once in a while, I just like to take a look to see if what I'm talking about is true. And I took a look at this Jesus Calling, and I didn't know what it was. I've heard about it and I've seen it. But Jesus Calling is written by a woman named Sarah Young. Now that should be a red flag right there, boom. Because the scripture does not give a woman the right to break the word. And we should not ever be going to a woman author to bring the word or understanding of the word. Never. It's never permitted in scripture. It's never anywhere allowed in the word or the message. So right away, devotion book written by a woman, unless it's teaching you how to love your husband, be a keeper at home, and love your children, then that's acceptable. Other than that, it's unacceptable. That's what the prophet told us. That's what the word of God says. But then he says, this woman, Sarah, she said, here's just the description of the book. After many years of writing her own words in her prayer journal, missionary Sarah Young decided to be more attentive to the Savior's voice and begin listening for what he was saying. So with pen in hand, she embarked on a journey that forever changed her and many others around the world. And these powerful pages are the words and scriptures Jesus lovingly laid on her heart. Words of reassurance, comfort, and hope. Words that have made her increasingly aware of his presence and allowed her to enjoy his peace. Each day is written as if Jesus himself were speaking to you because he is. Do you hear him calling? So in Jesus Calling, we have this woman, Sarah, who decided in my prayer journal, in her prayer journal, she was just praying and then writing things out. But she decided, I don't want to do that anymore. What I'm going to do is I'm going to sit and listen for Jesus to tell me something. And when Jesus tells me something, I'm going to write down what he says. What does that make her? A prophetess. Because if she is taking what Jesus says and writing it down as coming from Jesus, and then putting it in a book and giving it out to you and I, and we take that book and we read it as Jesus speaking to Sarah. You see how dangerous that is? What if her doctrine is wrong? What if what she says didn't come from Jesus? What if she was hearing from another spirit? What if that woman, she's definitely a medium. Without a doubt, she's a medium. She's a medium for what spirit? Is she a medium for Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, or is she a medium for another spirit, because you can't be both? And if the things she writes in her book are doctrinally incorrect, she's not keeping the word and contradicting the word, then she is not hearing from the Holy Spirit. She is a false prophetess. She's hearing from another spirit. She's putting it in a book, and we're opening the book and reading the book and opening our hearts to something that is false and not from God. But there's only two sources for anything, right? You either get it from heaven or you get it from hell. And if we're reading that and opening our spirits, we're opening ourselves to an evil spirit. Now, I'm not being mean. I'm being honest. This is why God gave us a message, so we wouldn't be duped by things like this. That, you know, the culture that we live in, we just go to the Bible bookstore. I do the same thing myself. Go to the Bible bookstore. Everything's Christian, right? So you just take it and you go and read it and you relax and you enjoy it. You're not expecting for the devil to be contaminating Christianity in this book. That wasn't your intention for buying the book. It wasn't my intention for the buying book. That's not the reason this is in our library, right? We never had that intention. You never had that intention. We just do what we've always done. We go to the Christian bookstore. We find some good reading material. I want another devotion book. And we grab it off the shelf and we sit down and start reading, trying to learn more about God, trying to receive more revelation of God or a better understanding of the word to help us in life. And we're opening ourselves to demon spirits. Think about it and think about whether that's true or not. So far, she sold 16 million books worldwide. Think about the influence of those words. She's a medium for a spirit. Now, you have to discern which spirit she's a medium for. She's a medium for a spirit world, and in mediating for a spirit world, she's writing down the thoughts that are coming to her as spoken to her. She says spoken to her from Jesus, writing them down and then propagating it to 16 million people that are being influenced by those words. The question is, did they come from Christ or not? That's an important question. If they did not come from Christ, then why are we reading it? Here's what she says in the beginning of this book. I just grabbed this off her shelf back there. They won't be there after tonight. See, God doesn't want his people deceived. He's bringing greater revelation and greater understanding. He's honing us down, because the only thing going in the rapture is the true, unadulterated, pure word. That's it. Nothing mixed, nothing blended. It's not going. She says, I yearned for more and more of God in my life, so I set aside time to listen in his presence and write down what I believed he was saying to me. My journal changed from monologue to dialogue. What spirit is she dialoguing with? Just because somebody says it's Jesus and Jesus told me, that doesn't mean Jesus told them. Satan appears as an angel of light. This new way, listen to this, this new way of communicating with God became the high point of my day. You mean there's a new way to communicate with God? In fact, listening to Jesus increased my intimacy with him more than any other spiritual discipline. So this medium, this thing she was doing, mediating and listening to this voice and writing down, it became more, she had increased in intimacy with him more than any other, more than reading her Bible. Think about that. More than reading the perfect word of God was this time where she would sit, open her mind, open her spirit, and hear from a voice and write that down. That brought her to a greater intimacy with Jesus than any other spiritual discipline she ever had before. Not the more than the preaching of the word, more than the reading of the Bible, more than anything else. So she goes down and starts talking about why she wrote this for children. Said, it's natural for children to love those who love them, so this is the ideal way for them to develop love for Jesus at a young age. See the deception. She's speaking to a spirit realm of love and affection, not the soul. Children love them. Children, it's natural for children to love those who love them. So in the book, she paints Jesus as loving you, always loving you, always loving you, because it's natural for children to love back. But what are the children loving back? So this is the ideal way for them to develop love for Jesus at a young age. So I just took two real quick, I just breezed through it in two little segments that she wrote. Now she writes it in the first person as if Jesus is speaking to the child. So the child is reading this as coming from Jesus. It says, "Oh, how I love to hear my children laugh. I want you to come to me no matter how you are feeling, when you are happy and can't stop smiling, when you are sad and want to cry, when you are mad, and even when you are ashamed or embarrassed. I understand everything about you, including all your feelings, and I love you." What has that got to do with the Word of God? All it is grabbing an emotional attraction and pulling a child in. Very dangerous. It's not that Jesus doesn't love you and care about all your emotions. It's, is that Jesus? Did Jesus say that? When you go to 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse this, that's what God said. When a woman says, "When I was sitting quietly, I took my pen and just waited for the Lord and I write down whatever he said," that's from Jesus. No, it's not. Give me the scripture. Give me the verse. That's what I want. Here's another one. I just grabbed two. "I am always with you in spirit. You cannot see me with your eyes, but I am always by your side. For now you see me only with spiritual eyes, the eyes of your heart. Someday, though, when your body dies, you will see me in person. I will come back and take you with me to heaven. We will be together forever." That's false doctrine. That's not true. Where in the Bible does it say that when your body dies, Jesus comes personally to you and gets you and takes you to heaven? Nowhere. That's a lie. Did the spirit that anointed this, is that the spirit of Christ? No, it's not. That's just one example, just one thing. And the reason I'm going through this is not, I've done the same thing. I've done the same thing. I have the same books. I have to go through and clean out a bunch of my garbage too, because now we're coming down to a razor's edge where the word and the word only is what's acceptable. And I feel a great sense of responsibility, because in Ezekiel 33, I'll just read it to you. It says, "Son of man, speak to the children of thy people and say unto them, when I bring the sword upon a land, if the people of the land take a man of their coast and set him for a watchman, if when he seeth the sword come upon the land and blow the trumpet and warn the people, then whosoever heareth the sound of the trumpet and taketh not warning, if the sword come and take him away, his blood shall be upon his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet and took not warning, his blood shall be upon him. But he that taketh warning shall deliver his soul. But if the watchman see the sword coming and blow not the trumpet and the people be not warned, if the sword come and take any person from among them, he is taken away in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at the watchman's hand." That's me. If I don't say what's true, and if I don't warn you about the dangers of this blended religion that's in the bookstore, I'm guilty, because I know it's true. Guess who the publisher for this book is? Thomas Nelson, who's owned by HarperCollins, who's owned by News Corp, who's owned by Rupert Murdoch. Not to be trusted. Brother Branham said in Questions and Answers, "Now, in order to be a correct pastor or minister, you've got to watch your congregation. If you see the enemy coming in and then slip right over here and say, 'Here, just a minute, see, now that's the wrong thing, see,' and then you're watching, the Bible said, 'Take heed to the flock, to feed the flock while the Holy Ghost has made you overseer over.' And now, if you fail to do that, God is going to make you answer for it." Brothers and sisters, I tremble when I read things like that, because I have a grave responsibility to tell you the truth. And I'm in a position that I wasn't in a few years ago, and I'm in a position that most of you are not in. I can sit and study these things for hours and hours and hours. It has taken me days to find the things that I found and make the connections I made. So I have a great responsibility just to present it to you. And what I'm telling you can be easily verified and easily found. It's not conspiracy, it's wide open. They're buying up all that, because why? There's great merchandise in Christian material. There's great money to be made, and when they buy it up and consolidate all the way back to Sony Pictures, all the way back to 20th Century Fox, all the way back to DreamWorks, now who's at the top pulling the strings? Who has absolute control? I wouldn't open myself to these things. You know, I'm going to say some things because I love you, just because I love you. If you and I need to watch War Room to know that we must pray, we have failed. We have failed, completely failed. If we have to watch Fireproof to fix our marriage, we have completely failed. We have the unadulterated, perfect Word of God. If that can't fix our marriage, we have the fullness of the Holy Ghost back in the church again. If that can't fix a marriage, if the Word of God, anointed by the Holy Ghost, can't fix a marriage, how is a movie going to do it? If we have to have War Room to inspire us to spend time in prayer, what about the scripture that says pray? Over and over and over again. What about Brother Branham who says over and over again, to be closer to God, read your Bible and pray. I didn't need a movie to tell me that. The prophet of God told me that. If I would just take the devotion book that God gave us and just read it, I wouldn't need a devotion book. I'm to the point now, I've never been a fan of them, but I'm less of a fan than I've ever been of devotion books. We spend 30 minutes reading a devotion book where it's one passage of scripture and 5 minutes of the thoughts of a man on the passage of scripture when we could just have 30 minutes of the word. Right? And if I need a commentary on the word because I can't understand it, then what about the prophet of God who is the commentary on the word? Why do I want somebody from a denominational system that believes in Trinitarianism that's false worshiping devils not knowing it? Why should I go there for my understanding of the scripture and my life application of that scripture when I've got the word and I've got the message? Why did the message come? So I needed a devotion book by Beth Moore? I don't need that book. I don't need the devotion book. I don't need the material in the Bible bookstore. I don't need to pass it out for gifts. I don't need to give it to my children. What I need is a good old-fashioned King James Bible and some spoken word books is exactly what I need because that's what God has given us to get us over. He didn't give us anything else. He gave us his word, and he brought a prophet who was thoroughly vindicated to point us back to this word and to show us the correct interpretation of the word. And now we have the correct interpretation of the word by divine inspiration. That's my devotion book. That's my commentary on the scriptures. It's not that it's wrong to ever read something or learn something else. We'll never, ever say this thing. This message has nothing to do with control. You can do whatever the Spirit leads you to do. You have the Holy Ghost. Rely on it. But just open our eyes with discernment and let's discern what we're reading. Just because it's parked in a shelf at the Bible bookstore doesn't mean it's safe, doesn't mean it's godly, doesn't mean it's even fit for a Christian to be looking at a reading. What we're doing is opening ourselves to confusion because whoever's writing this is writing from this perspective and the prophet of God is bringing the bride the word they need for the hour and they're in direct contradiction to one another. Yes. What do we do with that? I'll tell you what we should do when we come across that. It should go in the garbage can. Because if it contradicts the word on one part, what does it do through the rest of the book? It cannot be trusted. So what can be trusted? This? And the message of the hour that's been backed up by divine vindication, that can be trusted because that's what's going to get you through. Well, I have so many troubles today. What's supposed to get you through? I've read devotion books. I'm pointing at myself. I'm in the same boat. But when we go to the devotion book or we go to the commentary, we go to this, we have no idea about the person who wrote that. You don't know what their religious beliefs are. You don't know what their theology is. You don't know what their life was like. You don't know if they've been married 4 times. You don't know if they believe in this, that, or the other. You don't know. But we're willing to pick it right off the shelf and spend hours and hours and hours reading through that. And we'll go to a devotion book for a 30-minute devotion every day, and the spoken word book never gets touched. Shame on us. God forgive us for that. You know why? Because the spoken word book does absolutely nothing for your flesh. But the little funny story and the little emotional grabbing thing that's written in the devotion book, that tantalizes your flesh all up and down. You read about mama who lost her baby and prayed to God and the answer that came and now all of a sudden we have all of this going on. That's not going to help you get out of here. All that's doing is creating an emotional reaction and tying you emotionally to the word. But we don't want to be tied emotionally to the word. We want to be fed in our soul. We want to be linked by the soul to the word. And the only thing that links us is the pure word of God. I mean, the problem with the movies, the Christian movies, the problem with the Christian movies is we don't use discernment when we watch them. Because they grip us with the story. Immediately there's the action. Then there's the problem. And then how are we going to solve the problem? And then we get caught up into the storyline, right? And so we're not watching with eyes of discernment, watching for the false doctrine, watching for the immorality. We've got to choke down, say, yeah, they shouldn't have done that. And oh, they shouldn't have done that. But we're so caught up in the story, we just keep plodding right along. And at the end, we're left with such a euphoric feeling because we come to the solution and God came on the scene and everybody's happy and it was miraculous. And I walk away and I feel so good that I forgot about the immorality that was before my eyes. I forgot about the way the women were dressed and the way the men were talking and for this scene and that scene. I have totally forgotten that. All I remember is that final feeling of happiness, peace, and joy. That is what's so dangerous about those movies. I'm telling you, this has changed my thinking. I hope it's changed yours. You know, what's not going to get you and I? The barroom. The prostitute. You name it. Heavy metal music, the public swimming pool, the public beach, those are not the things that we're in danger of. What we're in danger of is Satan in the disguisement of Christianity coming in and contaminating Christianity. That's what we're in danger of. What we need to do is we need to take up the book and we need to peel up the label very carefully and see what's under the Christian label because it's not true Christianity. It's blended religion. And what we're getting is a whole lot of Romanism, a whole lot of Babylonian religion coming through. Even in this book, you probably can't see it, but even in this book, there's a shepherd here with a sheep. And that shepherd's crook has a spiral at the top of it. Have you ever seen a shepherd's crook with a spiral at the top? That doesn't work. It's got a hook so they can hook the neck or the foot of the sheep. That spiral is a pagan symbol. No shepherd's crook ever had a spiral at the top. It's useless. That is a pagan symbol, and that's the same symbol on the staff of St. Peter over in Israel when he's coming out of the sea. He's got a staff with that spiral right on top of it. Come from Babylon, right to Rome, to Catholicism, right into your child's book. You can do nothing without an anointing. What is the anointing? I can't tell you for sure, but I know what this is anointed by. And I know what my church age book is anointed by. And I know what my seals book is anointed by. And I'd rather take what precious little time I have left, the beginning or end of a day, and not spend it with something that has a question mark attached to it. I'd rather go to the sure fountain of living water that without a doubt I know is pure and crystal clean and flows without contamination of man. And that's your Bible, and that's the message. Telling you, brothers, sisters, that's the ticket out of here. That's the solution to every problem you and I face, is the word. What did he tell what was his final, those were Joshua's final instructions we read there in Joshua 24 and 23. His final instructions was, be very courageous to keep all the word and not to stray to the right or to the left. Then he says, if you would all take from the nations and go back, then your victory will stop. Wow. If you find yourself with a stopped victory in your life, I was overcoming pornography, I was overcoming addiction, I was overcoming a lying tongue, and I've stopped and I've lost my overcoming. If you've lost your overcoming, then I would drop everything that comes from any other source. And I would be very courageous to keep only the word. Not a movie, not music, not Christian literature. I would go back and dive myself completely, wholeheartedly, as much time as I could put into the word of God, to the message of the hour, and watch your victory come back. Your victory will absolutely come back because the Holy Ghost lives by the Word of God. It doesn't live by the trash in the Bible bookstore. It lives by the pure Word of God. And if you're finding yourself without strength to have victory, forget the trash, dump the movies, dump the video games, dump the other books, dump everything if you're not having victory and come back to the source. Because the Holy Ghost is strengthened by the Word and lives off the Word, and you get wholeheartedly dedicated to that pure Word of God, and you watch your victory come back. Amen. Victory over your tongue, victory over your temperament, victory over all of these things, victory over the eyes. Watch it come back. Because it's promised. These are promises. I'm so sick and tired of watching people live and struggle and compromise. We have a promise, we have a word, and we have the fullness of the Holy Ghost. Not a portion, the fullness of the Holy Ghost. And if that can't overcome, then we're doomed, friends. But the problem is we want the Holy Ghost to come down and pick us up, shake all the stuff off of us, and move us to where we need to be. That's not how it works. What we have to do is we got to come to the source. We've got to get in the stream and dedicate ourselves completely. Young men, if you want victory, forget your games. If you want victory, forget that daily routine of video games, computer games, videos on YouTube. Forget all that garbage. If you want victory to be a son of God, then you get right back into the Word of God. You read that word every day, and you read the message every day, and you tell me if you don't have victory. Because if you say, well, I tried it, it doesn't work, that's absolute baloney, because if you try it, it will work, because the word works. Right. Amen. Amen. It's time to quit fooling around. We have to completely stop. God has given us a message. Why? I think he wants us to read it. God has went through tremendous difficulty and tremendous strides to bring it and present it in every form you can imagine, in every continent, almost every continent, and almost so many nations around the world so many times, and discernment after discernment, and type after type, and shadow after shadow, so that we would see clearly what this is, vindicated of the Lord. Why? So it can get our partial attention? So it can get our partial affection? No. So we can be solely devoted to this one thing. That's our victory. Who wants victory? It's in the Word, brothers and sisters. Let's stand. Musicians, if you could come. Amen. I'm not a fan of preaching this way. I don't necessarily always like being the watchman on the wall, but I tremble when I read the scriptures that says, obey them that have the rule over you as those that watch over your souls and must give an account. I have to give an account. Now that I have clearly laid out what I have seen, now I'm no longer responsible. I'm free from responsibility. Now you must take what you heard. I got to do the same thing. I got to take what I've heard and what I've learned, and I've got to find out what's the truth. And I've got to commit myself completely to the truth. This word is more powerful than we give it credit for. Why is it we look everywhere else in a time of trouble but to the very thing God gave us?
Right.
We've got to have faith in the thing that God gave us. And we have to exercise our free choice. We have free choice. We have to exercise our free choice and make decisions that align us back to what God has given us. That's my desire for every one of us. That's my desire for myself. Amen. The victory, the overcoming, the body change, it's all in the revealed word. It's going home time. It's later than we think. Brother Branham said it was later than we think in 1963, 1964, 1965. If it was later than we think then, it must be later, later, later than we think. And I'm tired of compromised religion. I'm tired of blended religion. I want the pure. God's given us the pure. I want the pure. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you, God, for this word. God, I just ask, God, that you would just take us, Lord, and shake us. You have shaken us tonight. You've shaken me, Lord. And God, my desire and the desire of everyone here is to serve you wholeheartedly, Lord. God, I pray that you would just help us to lay down all the things of the world, the things that are like the world, the things that are mixed with the world. Help us, Lord, to throw those things to the side. Help us, Lord, to grab your word that you have given to us. Oh, Lord, that's what I want. That's the cry in my soul. That's the cry of the heart of your children. We want it, Lord. When we hear this, that's what we want. And Lord, I just pray, God, that you would just meet us as we come to you and read your word and sit at your feet daily, Lord. I pray, God, that you'd begin to feed us and strengthen us. Give us power for overcoming, Lord. Let your Holy Ghost be upon us in a more powerful way. Fill us afresh with your Spirit, O Lord, and help us to dedicate ourselves wholly to your word. We love you, God. We give you all of our lives. We dedicate ourselves to you. I ask that you go with everyone, Lord, that's leaving. God, that you would just minister to each heart, Lord. God, no doubt there's many of us that have to go home and look around, but I pray that you'd give us spiritual discernment of the Holy Ghost, that we can judge things, Lord, with spiritual eyes and learn what is good and what is not good, Lord, according to your word. Let your Spirit make us extra sensitive, Lord, that we might follow your leading, I pray. God, lead us in the paths of righteousness for your name's sake. For we love you, Lord, and we ask your blessings. As we go with us, Lord. Protect us and keep us on the way till we come again. We pray, Lord, that you would move on your heart to your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can we sing that song, I Want to Live the Way He Wants Me to Live? Let's sing this song together as you're dismissed. God bless you. We love you very much. Amen. Praying for you.
I want to live the way He wants me to live. I want to give until there's just no God of this evil age has blinded the eyes today of people who walk their own way, not according to God's word, denying the things he's done, sending his own accepting the creeds of man, rejecting the word of God. Yes, this is the evening time. Oh, it's later than you think. The bride is preparing now for darkness throughout this land. This world cannot understand that a prophet has walked this land, proclaiming the way to God. If you would be saved today, then follow the words he gave, accepting the word of God. This is the evening time. Later than you think, the bride is preparing now for her Lord to meet, and all things are ready now. The bridegroom I hear, for he that have an ear. Time is here. Let's sing that second verse again. There's darkness throughout this land. This world cannot understand that a prophet has walked this land, proclaiming the way to God. If you would be saved today, follow the words he gave, accepting the word of God, for this is the evening time. Yes, this is the evening time. It's later than you think. The bride is preparing now for her Lord to meet, and all things are ready now. The bridegroom I hear, for he that hath an ear to hear, the evening time is here. Take up your cross, follow Jesus. Just take up your cross every day, and don't be ashamed to say that you know him. Count the cost, then take up the cross and follow him. I'll take up my cross and I'll follow Jesus. I'll take up my cross every day. I'll not be ashamed to say that I know. My cross and follow him. Just let your book live in me, dear Lord, and show me myself within thy word. Oh, show Savior, and let the book live.
were mine stayed on me, stayed on me, faithfully, and I will give you perfect peace, sweet release, if you'll just keep your mind stayed on me. Unto you.